And you know, after the Brexit negotiations, this is another area, because of my connections with the North, is the Good Friday Agreement has clauses in it for bilateral consultations on all matters between Ireland and Britain. But we refused to use the Good Friday Agreement to talk to the British. We said we can't talk to the British, it's going to go through Brussels. Even though we were in a much different situation than anyone else, we should have put up our hands up immediately and said, we are a special case. We need a special arrangement with Britain. We need a special arrangement with Europe. But no, it was decided that we would be as strong a European as the strongest European. And it just made absolutely no sense. And it wasn't questioned enough. Our sole policy since that period has been to say the British have to ignore Brexit or else they've got to agree to a Brexit which is so mild that it makes no difference. Now, if we had had a referendum here and if we had decided on some areas and the British were telling us what to do, we'd go mad, and we'd be rightly so. But it doesn't seem to dawn that you know, doing this and telling a country how to behave is not really what it's all about. And I agree with Ray, the other Ray, about the nature of the European Union. When I started working first, the European Union officials were probably their friends. They were actually very, very helpful. They were supportive of government. Then when I went to Canada, you come off against a completely different animal altogether, where you are just a subsidiary part. And a good example of that was during the height of the crisis, the Irish government, through the embassy in Ottawa, asked the Canadian government to open up Canadian immigration to young Irish people, because there wasn't enough jobs in this country at the time. The only way we could help. And the Canadian government, who had an Irish-Canadian minister by the name of Jason Kenney, agreed to give 10,000 visas, two-year visas, to Irish people. When the European Union heard about this, they said, well, what about the rest? Poland is only 80. The UK in total gets 5,000. But Ireland is way out of line, Ireland and France. And I remember the Canadian immigration minister said, I gave that to Ireland because my family were starved out of Roscommon in the 1840s, and it was a way of paying some ancestral debt back. He said, if the European Union wants special visas, then that's the end of the program. But it was this idea that anything we got was theirs, and they could do it. And same with Irish organizations. I wanted a list of every Irish organization in Canada to be listed under the European Union. Now, people out in Newfoundland wouldn't know what you were talking about, but these people wanted to take anything that they could from the member states. And it was a totally different relationship. The relationship in the 80s and the 90s was one of great cooperation, some of your best friends in it. But by the time the various treaties had worked through and the European Union people, especially in third countries, felt that they were the federal ones and we were the equivalent of the county councils. And that was very, very difficult to test. But one of the arguments I've been saying all the time is that circumstances change. And you've always got to decide where the balance of advantage lies. And my own belief now is that the balance of advantage has moved very heavily away from our membership of the European Union. Simply because if you look at all the recent initiatives from Europe, they're almost all against our interests. I can't think of an area where suddenly Europe took over our interests and ran with it. Whether it's in the corporate taxation area, whether it's the ECB forcing our banks to sell off large swathes of the housing market to vulture funds, even on telling us when we should have summertime and wintertime. It's almost a stage where we're literally losing the last bit of sovereignty. And it always strikes me as amazing that I regularly get criticized for being unpatriotic, for trying to maintain our sovereignty, while the people who are trying to sell it are trying to wrap the green flag around them.